from orbital station Meteosat 4, the most accurate forecast.
I don't believe this. It's going to be cold overnight with the ground frost in places. The low 3 Celsius, that's 37 degrees Fahrenheit. Later today, sunshine and scattered showers with a cool northerly wind. Maximum temperature 16 Celsius, 61 degrees Fahrenheit. The outlook Wednesday, scattered showers, dry with sunny spells on Friday. Temperature now 8 Celsius, that's 46 degrees Fahrenheit. Beacon Radio. Midnight Line on Beacon and WABC. And you can talk about anything you want to talk about. Okie dokie, me old culture lovers, we're off. 754123 in Wolverhampton, 236 235 in Shrewsbury. Somebody's leaving some rather strange notes on our blog. You hunky, sexy, gorgeous creature of the night. I don't think that's meant for me somehow. Anyway, what have we got? We got a free-for-all, so you can talk about anything you want to talk about. Last week we talked about all sorts of wild and wonderful and interesting things that totally escaped my memory because I had something of a boozy weekend, I'm afraid. There you go. Loads of vodka, loads of lager, loads of problems being stood up for my later life. I went to, what did I go today? We went to the Spider's Web Cafe just by the M54 and I had the Triple Heart Bypass Special. It's wonderful, it's so full of cholesterol, it's beaut. Very naughty. Anyway, last week we talked about juvenile crime. How do you solve it? How do you stop juveniles from committing crimes? Some people say you lock them up. Other people say, well, if you lock them up, then all you do is turn out graduates in crime. And even more people have a different opinion. They say that what you got to do is you have to send them on holiday to Spain for 3 months or Portugal or somewhere like that with a social worker. I just bet, I mean, shoot me down in flames if I'm wrong, but I just bet that it was a social worker who thought that one up. Hello? Can we help? Oh, right, okay, fine. It's Christian. Let's hear it for Christian. Yay! Thank you. One of the Batroom boys. I think that's what we call you, isn't it? Amongst other things. Yes, thank you. Good night, Christian. Okie dokie, what else did we talk about last week? Well, I can't remember, but it's bound to have been interesting. But you can talk about anything, like how Liverpool are most definitely going to win the league after the 5-0 thumping of Swindle Town, which will teach Swindle Town to cheat Tranmere Rovers out of 3 points, which is what they did last season, allegedly, when the floodlights broke. So tough luck, Swindle. And by the way, you're going to get another one of those when you come to Anfield, if not worse. I believe some other Northern team has been down here tonight, but we don't want to talk about that lot. They had some saggy win. Lucky United. They were lucky again last night. So, who's going to win the Football League? It's patently obvious it's going to be Liverpool. Nobody else is even going to be close. Now that we have Captain Haddock at the back. So I found out today that that's what they call Ruddock on the cop, Captain Haddock. Okay, but it is a free-for-all, so you can talk about anything you want to talk about. I'd like to talk to a beautician. I'd really desperately need to talk to a beautician about preserving of suntans, because mine is fading rapidly. You can still see the white bits between my fingers there, if I hold that up to camera 3. And claim to fame, if you've got a claim to fame, that, I don't know, maybe Billy Bragg's your uncle or something like that, I don't know, then do tell us, because we like claims to fame on this programme. 754123 in Wolverhampton, 236 235 in Shrewsbury. Before we go to the lines, let's have a look at the mailbag. Crap postcard competition's in its last week. You've got to get your entries in by Thursday, because with any luck and a following wind, the captain's going to be in on Friday, and he's going to judge who wins the Culture Lovers Do It at Midnight t-shirt. Very exclusive. And then after that, we'll have another competition so that I get heaps of mail. Because when I get heaps of mail, you see, the boss thinks I'm incredibly popular. So, oh, that's good, isn't it?
You lost it.
No, I have not lost it. James just came in and gave me my list of who we got on the phone lines and dropped under the desk, but I've retrieved it. You're very kind. Okay, right, who's been writing to me? Some mad people around in this world. Very mad. Including June, who, it's a tacky postcard competition. So what she's done, she's got a blank postcard and sellotaped 2 packets of carpet tacks to it as her tacky postcard. You're a very, very strange woman, June. Very, very strange indeed. Is that, no, that's not June's letter. June did send a covering letter. That's not June at all. It's Julie. Julie Trenter. in Ashwood Park. She says, "Dear Ian Perry, please enter my postcard into your competition. I searched everywhere for one that fits the description of tacky. To no avail, I prepared my own, so here it is, the one I made earlier." Very good. Back to camera three for that one. "I hope it complies with the rules, but if not, please bend them." The rules, that is. Thanks a lot, Julie. Okay, there we go. Of course it complies with the rules. Here's a triple entry from Lillian Mellor. And "You didn't hear me right, Miss Jones. I said I'll have to lay you off." Miss Jones getting her kit off there. So that's a very sexist one. they're quite rude, these. The nudist colony karate expert chops wood with his bare hands. "Blimey, I think he's chopped something else this time." And the man is obviously in some considerable agony. Thanks for those. We'll put those up there. She writes, "Welcome back to WABC and Beacon. I listened to your show for ages now. May I say how very much I enjoy it? Certainly gives food for thought. After ringing in to talk to John Starkey for the last 6 months or more, I finally got through on your last programme before you went away, but sadly the time ran out before I could get to talk with him. I would have liked to wish you a good holiday, but it seems you did anyhow. Have a good holiday. Enclosed, please find 3 tacky postcards for your competition. Thanking you for the most welcome company. Please could you send me a photograph of yourself?" We must get those sorted out. I could do, Lillian, but you haven't put your address on. Not that we have any anyway, so it's all rather academic. Thanks for that, Lillian. Richard Dodd, he says, "I've been listening to the Midnight Line for nearly 3 years. I'm an under the duvet kilt lover, so good morning to the 1st Battalion under the duvet kilt lovers. Please find enclosed my entries for your tacky postcard competition. I thought you'd like the one from France as soon as I saw it, knowing how much you loved the French. I didn't go to France myself." No, of course not. Not that you'd admit it. "Learning the language for 5 years was bad enough. Oui. J'ai agréé," whatever it is in French. "The other card gave me a laugh when I bought it from Wales. Another place I know you love. Yes, lovely, lovely Wales. Good morning to the Third World. Hope you like the cards. And remember, drive carefully, be nice to mum and ride free." There we go. There we have the smallest house in Great Britain by night. That's highly hilarious, Richard. Thank you for that. And Normandy, with the sign of a paratrooper. It's a little fishing smack, and it's all jolly nice. Thank you. Okay. 267 Technol Road in Wolverhampton, 28 Castle Street in Shrewsbury. That's where you send any correspondence that you may have. Let's go to the lines. Free for all. Let's speak to Mavis. Mavis is on this line here. Good morning, Mavis.
Good morning, Ian.
Oh, there's lovely, isn't it? There's me saying horrible things about the Welsh, and the first person on is Welsh.
I thought you'd be saying that right.
Oh, no. Yeah. Isn't it?
Anyway, welcome back.
Been to chapel, have you?
Yes. Welcome back anyway.
You're very kind.
While you were sunning yourself in Greece.
I was working incredibly hard.
Come off it. There was I, working like mad down in South Wales.
South Wales?
Yeah.
What were you doing in South Wales?
Well, I was looking after my sister, helping to sort her out, because you know she got cancer. So she hasn't been able to do very much, so I've been doing quite a lot of work for her.
So you weren't working as a miner then?
No, I brought a miner on with me, though.
Did you now?
Yes, ooh. One of those miners carved out of coal.
Tacky, Mavis. It's very, really, very tacky.
No, it's really nice. I'd love to show you if I can one day perhaps see you. It's really good.
You haven't got one of those picture of a horse running along a beach, have you? Who bought them? Somebody must have bought them, because they sold them in Woolies for years.
So no, I haven't.
I tell you what, we'll open the lines and we'll say that if you want to grass somebody up for hanging one of those dreadful prints in their house, 754123 in Wolverhampton, 236235 in Shrewsbury, because the other one was the native woman, wasn't it?
Well, I brought a dreadful one, being of the mines, you know, because obviously the mines are closing down, so I've decided to buy a print
of
that
a
I
mine.
Can hang up my wall.
Well, what's a print of a mine look like then? Somebody just paints
it. Very, very good.
Don't you just get a bit of white card and paint it black?
Yes.
And say, this is the mine.
Yes.
So you've got a coal miner?
No, it's the village. It's a print of the village where I come from, where the mines are.
Where?
Obviously, I'm keeping it because my father was the longest serving mine in Penalta Pit in South Wales.
Oh, yes, they still speak about him, you know.
They do. Well, I hope so. He's been dead a long time.
Oh, they still speak in awe of him down the local and at chapel.
Probably does.
When they have the tea and biscuits evening and bingo at chapel.
Yeah, I saw what he liked and enjoyed.
Absolutely. What can we do for you?
First of all, Ian, I was reading in the paper today about British Rail and the price increases.
It's all right, it's in the southeast.
Yes, I know, but the thing about it is, don't they realise that they've taken the people off the trains, not putting them back on it again?
What, by increasing
by
the cost?
By increasing the fares, but, I mean, really well above inflation, isn't it?
But they got you by the dog's danglers, haven't they?
They certainly have, haven't they? I mean, I would travel certainly much more often if the trains were a little bit, the fares were a little bit less.
I wouldn't.
Oh, I would.
No, I don't do public transport.
Oh, you don't? No. Oh, well, you're lucky you obviously got your motorbike. Have you got your new one yet?
I haven't, but I've been razzing around at the weekend on a Triumph Daytona, which street bike in Dudley. Thank you very much to Andy and Gary. They've kindly lent me, so I've been running around on that.
Oh, well,
and it's frighteningly fast. It's the best argument I've ever ridden for developing a fashionable line in brown leather.
I still yet to see that leather that you wore when you was at that... Oh, what was it called in Birmingham?
The Sadomasochist night.
I was going to see you, but I couldn't get there because the car broke down.
Birmingham, was it?
It was in Birmingham. Wasn't it Bingley Hall or something?
Oh, Himley Hall.
Yeah.
Oh, yes, head to toe in black leather with a black motorcycle helmet on and dark glasses, so you couldn't really see what I looked like.
Oh, well, you said you were buying a new leather coat at that particular time, didn't
oh,
you?
I still haven't got that. Well reminded. I must do something about that.
Yeah.
So, everybody's got to put the prices up there, haven't they?
Yeah, but I think it's ridiculous because, as I said, I mean, you look at the buses, the fares are gone up, the train fares are gone up, I mean, the roads are getting busier, more cars on the road. I mean, the thing I thought they wanted to get the people off the roads into public transport. They don't seem to be going about it the right way, are they?
But, I mean, on the odd occasion I do take a train, it always seems to be packed. I mean, especially if you come up from London.
Yeah, I know.
For our annual day out to Wembley.
Yeah.
If you get the train back to the Midlands, then you spend most of your time sat in the guards van.
Well, this is the point. I mean, there's not enough trains on the lines, are they? They're not. I mean, every hour or every 2 hours to Chester from Shrewsbury, it has been in the past, hasn't it? You know what I mean?
Well, there's not even a direct line now, is there, from Shrewsbury to London?
Well, to be honest, I haven't been there for a long time, so I don't know.
You haven't missed anything. It's a dreadful city, London. I can't imagine why anybody would want to live or work there.
No. Can I go on to drugs, Ian?
Well, I would advise you not to, because it's highly addictive and it's against the law.
Yeah, I know.
Mavis is doing drugs, everybody.
Yeah. Now, I was down in South Wales and there was the 100th centenary of Llanbradach.
Oh, of course. I was only saying at the weekend it's the 100th centenary of that unpronounceable Welsh thing this week.
Oh, well, there was one in Llanbradach.
Llanbradach.
Yeah, in South Wales.
Yes, lovely.
Right.
What is it?
Now, the 100th centenary.
Yeah, I know that. But
it's a village. It's
of
a village.
What?
It's a small village.
Oh, the village has been there 100 years.
Yeah.
That's no small achievement for a village in this day and age.
It is, isn't it? Anyway, while I was down there, they had, of course, all street parties, and they had a disco out in the tennis courts out in the green, you know, places of the hills of Wales, and
what a shame I couldn't be there.
I know, it was really great. It was really great. But the only problem was there was a gang of teenagers and they were smoking what they call wacky backy. I've never heard of it until this last couple of years.
Me neither. Well, what's wacky backy then?
Yeah. Well, I've never heard of it. It's supposed to be a non-addictive drug, isn't it?
Yes. This would be the non-addictive drug that Bob Marley smoked addictively.
Well, myself, I think it's the drug that starts to lead you off onto the most harder drugs anyway, to me.
Well, yeah, I think if I can remember back to in the dark, distant past of university and all that, when I did drug abuse. No, I meant I studied it. I didn't abuse drugs or anything. I think that one of the theories is that if you smoke cannabis, then you are more likely to hang around a social group that is into harder things and therefore be more exposed to it.
Yes.
It's not a sort of physiological progression from one to a harder one.
Yes, well, this is what I feel. But the thing was, while I was down there, there was a gang of youths who were smoking the wacky backy. And I saw a young lady with two young children. She went over to two policemen.
Well, what would you do if you lived in Wales?
I certainly wouldn't smoke wacky backy.
Oh, all right, so the woman went over to the police.
Yeah, she went over to the policeman and she turned around and told the police officers that, you know, they ought to go down there and sort these youths off because they obviously knew that they were smoking drugs. there. Like, you know, she said, I brought my two young children here. She said, for the family entertainment. She said, I don't want to see my children exposed, she said, to young, you know, youth.
I should hope she didn't.
Pardon?
I should hope she didn't expose her children.
This is what she was feeling. This was her point of view.
Anyway, I always thought it was quite entertaining watching them get arrested.
Well, the police went over and eventually did get rid of the youngsters, but I mean, they didn't sort of take them in or anything like that. But you know what I found worst of all, Ian, was when I was down Wales, the deterioration in South Wales, it's been a beautiful valley. I mean, the friendliness of the people has been wonderful over the years, but I could see the deterioration in my own land of Wales, as you call it, you know, and it seems so sad. At night time, you can see all the young youth coming out, and it's usually smoking the drug, the wacky-backy, or come to that, hard drugs. It was a very sad sight to see.
Is that because there's nothing else to do? Is it just escapism?
I think basically this is it. I think a lot to do with it is the unemployment, young people, you know, hanging out on the street, nothing to do, just smoking. I mean, a few young lads that I knew that were decent young lads, you know, while at school, have gone on to it, and they're as high as kite most days now because they're smoking drugs. But it was very, very sad to see this happening.
Okay, listen, Mavis, we've got to move on.
Okay, then. I'm glad you're back anyway.
You're very kind.
Okay, bye.
Ta-ra. There we go. Mavis talking about, amongst other things, the social decay she experienced when she went to South Wales. 754-123 in Wolverhampton, 236, 235 in Shrewsbury. If you want to grass somebody up for having one of a picture in the lounge of one of those, what is it, three or four horses running along the seafront, you know, the ones that you can get from Woolies. Well, I think Woolies used to sell them. If you want to grass somebody up for having one of those, then do tell us. Who have we got next? We've got the Wingnut. Good morning. Except he's listening to his wireless, you bad, naughty Wingnut. Oh, here it comes.
Good morning.
Good morning.
How are you?
I'm very well. I'd be even better if you could turn your wireless down.
I've done it, sir.
You're a very kind person.
And you're a very kind person, too.
What can we do you for?
Well, first, can I put an emergency call out for anybody who's in my area who's got some milk?
Milk?
I've come to work.
How much?
About half a pint.
Oh, just enough for some tea?
Just enough for some tea, and I will sort them out some goodies.
Because you could have been making the world's biggest omelette or something.
Or the world's biggest large custard.
Yeah, absolutely, in which case you would need a damn sight more than half a pint, wouldn't you?
Quite a few cows, yes.
So whereabouts are you?
It's Lebs Bakery, Donington.
Okay, so, and what do you get for your half pint of milk?
Sort them some goodies out.
Well, by goodies, I mean what?
Two cakes.
Oh, cakes. I thought it might mean something like Samantha Fox or something like that.
Oh, is she a goodie, is she?
Goodish, yeah.
Goodish, yes.
I wouldn't kick her out of bed to get to you, let's put it that way, shall we?
I don't think I'll kick her out of bed to go on the phone, to be honest, but there you have it. Right, sir.
So you just wanted some milk?
Yes, please.
Okay. All right, so if anybody's got any milk, take it to the Wingnut.
Thank you very much.
That it?
No.
Oh.
Go back to those operations last week.
Thought we got off a bit lightly.
Sorry to upset you like that.
The operations?
Yeah, when there was people talking about this heart operation this chap had.
Now, this was the smoker who didn't have a heart operation, was it?
That's right.
And because
he had the one, and then they refused to do him again, didn't they?
Yeah, unless he gave up smoking.
I think it might be because the nicotine doesn't, you know, kills the drugs that's related to the treatment.
Does it?
Well, in some cases, yes.
Thank you, Dr. Wingnut.
Well, I've broke my nose twice, and I get really bad...
What, today?
No, and this is in the past. Like, I get really bad decongested. Well, after trying everything that you can get off the shelf...
You go around talking like Frank Sidebottom.
Sometimes, yeah. Sometimes like that. And trying everything off the shelf and going down the... asking the quacker one day about something about it, if he could recommend anything.
Vacuum cleaner, mate, that's what you need.
And he said, it's a waste of time giving you anything because if you smoke, the drugs won't work.
So you reckon this was... Well, if that was the... If that was the reason, then I would have thought the medical profession could extricate itself from the doo-doo it appears to be in, simply by saying, well, we didn't operate because the drugs wouldn't be effective. But noticeably, they didn't.
No, well, that's it. Well, this is why I wondered if that was what was behind it, or if they, you know, it was a case of... They're just getting that fed up of operating on people, because they smoke. I know when my wife was in hospital last year, there was a chap come down there smoking in the day room, and he was from the heart ward, and he said, I've got to chew gum and mince and what have you, because if I go back smelling of tobacco, they'll go mad at me, and smoke.
Is it up to the medical profession to take a stance?
It's Sorry?
Is it up to the medical profession to take a stance?
I don't know. To be honest. I think it's because they, you know, they see it every day. They're there and they see it every day, and they're operating on people every day who've just, you know, smoked for endless years. And then they send them away home and they carry on smoking and they're back in again because it just brings the same thing back on again.
Okie dokie, listen, Mr. Wingnut, we have to move on, but we hope you get your milk.
Well, thank you.
And we'll speak to you very shortly.
I've got a good piece of rope for any lead supporters who are listening who might want to borrow it.
I think they probably will Saturday afternoon, right, okay, about 20 to 5.
Ha ha!
Ha ha ha!
Got the pool, have they?
Yes, they have.
I'm a Man United supporter. I'm the one. I'll own up to it.
It's you, is it?
It's me.
I must admit, I was looking around my local at the weekend and the plethora of United shirts.
They all seemed to come out of the woodwork then, did they?
Well, they did at the end of last season, but there weren't that many United shirts being worn on Saturday night.
I think a lot of them do, you know. I've seen it with all teams. They wait until the team's winning, and suddenly you start seeing an influx of all these shirts everywhere.
Well, yeah, there was one kid had a scarf with a picture of Bobby Charlton on it. That's how old it was. Hasn't seen the light of day since the late 60s.
Oh, well.
Well, Mr. Wingnut, you ain't going to win the league because Liverpool are.
Ha ha.
Ha ha.
We'll see.
Ta-ra.
Thank you. Good night.
There we go, the Wingnut. So if you can get him some milk, he'll be jolly grateful. He'll give you two cakes. What a fantastic deal, and one not to be missed. 754-123 in Wolverhampton, 236-235 in Shrewsbury. It's a free-for-all on the Midnight Line at Beacon and WABC. Andrew says, A, say hello to Andrew, and B, use E45 cream to preserve your tan. There we go. So anybody got any better advice? Like, I don't know. Vinegar or something? I don't know. I mean, there's all these old wives' recipes for various things, isn't there? Is the one for preserving suntans. Did your old granny tell you how to preserve a suntan? Probably not. 754-123 in Wolverhampton, 236-235 in Shrewsbury, and Has the La Vista Babies. We'll be back after these.
You know, people often ask, how do the Singing Mounties stay so cool? Well, it's like this. Take it away, boys!
From the sands of the Sahara to the heat of Kathmandu, the Labatt's Singing Mounties are always brave and true.
And cool,
though our horses may perspire by the bucketful, with our ice-cold Labatt's we will keep our cool.
Brewed in the UK, Labatt's Canadian Lager. It's so cool, it's cold.
On summer mornings, the hush is near perfect. You might just catch the murmur of the riverbed, or perhaps a snatch of birdsong. But nothing else can disturb the stillness, except for
all those people rushing to pick up a new Renault before prices go up on September 15th. Deals at these outstanding summer prices include 0% finance on petrol Renault 19s and Clios, and there's a £460 cash back on all Renault diesel cars. So hurry down now before they...
all go.
Finance subject to status and cashback offers end October 29th. For written details, call Renault UK on 0800 52 51 50.
Set sail with Beacon Radio this November for our fantastic listeners' cruise to Sweden. We depart on Friday the 26th of November aboard the Princess of Scandinavia, a superb floating hotel where you can enjoy restaurants, bars, cinema and even a sauna. We travel overnight to Gothenburg, one of Sweden's most beautiful cities, where we'll take a guided tour of all the sights, returning Sunday night with souvenirs and a memory of a great trip. It's a smorgasbord of fun for just £74 per person. You can find out more by calling 0255 241 234 and ask for extension 663. That's 0255 241 234.
It's a rich man's world.
Line on Beacon and WABC. Free for all, so you can talk about anything you want to talk about. 754-123 in Wolverhampton, 236-235 in Shrewsbury. I was watching the telly at the weekend and I couldn't believe my eyes. I couldn't believe what they were advertising now. I mean, first of all, it was women's thingies. You know. All right, I'll say it. Tampons. There we go. I've said it now. And at the weekend, I mean, all right, fair enough. I mean, yeah, I accept all the Ben Elton-esque arguments that if it was a bloke who had to do it every month and we'd talk about it more and all the rest of it. But I do draw the line at advertising thrush creams. Thrush? I was eating me dinner. And this woman turns up and says, I get thrush. Ah! Nasty. Horrid. Take it off. I don't want to watch that. There. What do you mean? You've got an off switch. You know, it only lasts 30 seconds. And there you are, quite happily eating a piece of chicken. The next thing the telly's talking about, thrush, yuck. When I was 18, I still thought thrush were the natural enemies of the men from Uncle. Turns out not. Turns out it's a yeasty sort of infection you can get. But don't worry, folks, because there's a cure. Because I've seen it on the telly. Yek, double yek. That should be taken off immediately. That should. Here we are next. We've got Paul next. Paul's on this line. Good morning, Paul.
Morning.
What can we do you for?
About prison reforms and whatever.
Yes.
They definitely should be made tougher. Definitely.
How do you make them? I would have thought it was tough enough being locked up and being deprived of your liberty.
Depends where you are, doesn't it? Because I know someone who's inside. He had a year to do when he went in. And at the end of 4 months, he's home every weekend.
And well, that Marcus Guppy fella, is it Marcus Guppy?
Or yeah.
Something. I mean, he gets to go and have sex with his wife, doesn't yeah. he?
But I mean, this guy comes out.
At probably most of his mates are as well, allegedly.
Yeah.
While he's away. Well, that's a bit much, isn't it? Just I mean, letting him out. Go and see to your wife.
I mean, this guy comes out at 6 o'clock every Friday night and goes back at 8 on a Sunday, and he also stays at home on bank holidays and Christmas.
What's the reasoning behind it?
He's got He's got a job on the outside, and he goes to work during the day, say from 8 till 6, and then goes back there every night.
So isn't it rehabilitation? Isn't it learning to live back in society? How long had he actually been out of society?
Four months.
That long ago?
Yeah, from April till the end of, beginning of August.
16 weeks?
Yeah.
16 weeks. You see, I could understand if it was 16 years.
Yeah.
But it's probably quite a good idea to release somebody gradually back into the community. It's like releasing a fish in a fish pond, isn't it?
Yeah.
Let it in a bit first.
Yeah.
Till it gets used to it. But 16 weeks, I mean, he's hardly forgotten how to handle money or anything like that.
Now, and he also gets bank holidays and Christmas and all that.
What? Oh, well, of course.
Yeah.
Double time bank holidays, presumably.
Yeah.
What did he go in for?
Fraud. So, I mean, he wasn't a serious offence, but I mean...
Well, I don't know, because if you look at the way British courts tend to deal with crime, if it's crime against the person... Yeah, it's nothing, mate.
Yeah.
But try ripping off the establishment for a few quid.
Yeah.
And they'll bang you up forever, unless, of course, you happen to be a knob.
Yeah.
Because who was that knob that they locked up? What was his name? Marcus of Blandford, was it?
Yeah.
Yeah. And they let him out.
Yeah.
Because I was looking forward to tours around his new ancestral home.
Yeah.
Yeah, I wondered if we're going to do guided tours. Like, that's me bunk, and that's where I slop out, and that's me bucket.
Yeah.
And that's me sink. And then they let him go. It just seems, I don't know, do you agree that the more money you have, the less harshly you tend to get treated by a court?
Yeah. But I mean, this place where he's out, they don't actually lock him up, they just sleep in dormitories, you can stop up and watch the TV all night and do whatever you want.
So it's not a punishment?
No, not really, apart from being away from your family. Apart from that, there's nothing.
I would imagine there's quite a few people up and down the country who'd see that as a positive benefit.
Well, yeah, I mean, they get people in there that don't actually want to go, because they've actually got nothing else.
So they keep going back?
Yeah.
How would you construct a prison regime, then?
Well, I don't know, but I think it should be a lot tougher than that, for a start.
I mean, treadmills, or more sewing mailbags?
Well, yeah, I mean, there's just no punishment being in a place like that. I mean, it's dead easy.
But I've never really considered prison... I mean, okay, it's probably a punishment. But I think that... If you're going to arrest somebody and show them the error of their ways, then that's precisely what you've got to do. You have to rehabilitate them.
Yeah.
And I've said it before, I'll say it again.
Yeah.
There's no point locking somebody up in a small room for 16 years or whatever and then expecting them to be different when they get out.
No.
Because it's got to be an exchange of ideas. They have to change. And
yeah.
I don't really see that a prison regime is conducive to that. I think it's probably the other way round.
Yeah. I mean, like, people who... go out like after 9 years or something, they find it very difficult to cope when they do go out because you haven't had to do it, you've had everything done for you.
Yes, that's when I could see it was sensible to let somebody out, find them a job, allow them to return to the prison and gradually integrate them back into society. But if he's only been away 16 weeks.
Yeah.
I mean, what happens if you walk out after 16 weeks and you go, God, everything's changed so much?
Yeah.
What's this then? Oh, this is the new 5p. Yeah.
And for those 4 months, he was out. He got 5 hours out every month for the first 4 months, anyway.
Sounds like nice work if you can get it.
Yeah.
All right then. So toughen up and make it a bit harsher, you reckon?
Yeah.
All right then,
all
Paul.
Right,
cheers, mate. We got Bill next. Good morning, Bill.
Hello, Ian.
Good morning. What can we do you for?
You're talking about suntans.
Yes, we were.
I used to live in Guernsey in the 60s, and...
Why did you come here?
And the reason that You never.
Did you know Bergerac?
No, he was in Jersey.
Well, it's only a small place, isn't it?
The reason you never peeled was you were in and out of the sea all the time, and you never peeled by keep in the seawater, out, in, out, in, out. And the pubs there used to open at all 9 o'clock in the morning, and we used to go in at 9 o'clock, and we'd get tanked up. By the time 12 o'clock come, we'd collapse on the beach. And one of the chaps, one of the Irish lads, we got him so drunk at 12 o'clock, he laid on the beach with all his shirt off, and everyone, it was a real hot day, so everybody went round and got all these beach pebbles, and they laid them on his chest, and they spelled out two very naughty words on his chest.
Which he sunburned into
and
him.
And the sunburn didn't catch, and then when he woke up and he found out what we'd done and he saw what was spelled across his chest, he was angry, I can tell you.
So your advice for me to preserve my suntan is go to the pub, get drunk and bathe in salt water afterwards.
Well, you had to go in and out of the sea, and we never
peeled. Well, I don't have any sea. Not in Finchfield.
Yeah, but we never peeled. And there used to be a chap there.
Well, that's all very well for you, isn't it? But what am I going to do?
And there was a chap there called Brummy John. I'd love to meet him again. He never peeled. He wouldn't go out in the sun because all he would go is pink. And he could never get tanned, and he went off to Israel with them, and they teased him about different things, and I'd love to know him again.
Maybe the problem was he wasn't going to the pub.
Well, he was always in the pub and out.
This is an integral part of suntanning, is it, going to the pub?
Because in Guernsey, there were so many of us, Irish, Guernsey, London, and we never knew each other's surnames. It was always like Belfast Mick, London Mick, or Yorkshire Jeff. And I'd love to meet all those lads again.
What were you doing there?
Oh, we were working on the tomatoes, building the docks, working on housing, building houses. And there was a wild lot, driving lorries, we were doing everything.
But not meeting Bergerac?
No, no.
No claims to fame in that department, yeah. Then?
But it was a real fun place to live, and them Irish lads were great.
So either I go to the pub, get drunk and bathe in salt water, or go and live in Guernsey.
In and out of the sea, yeah.
Okay, go and live in Guernsey. I think that's probably the best advice I've had about how to maintain my suntan. Thank you very much. Who we got next? Who's on this line? Hello? Excuse me. James? No? All right, we'll find out. Who's on this line?
Who?
You.
Patrina.
Hello, Patrina.
How are you?
Can't get the staff, that's the problem. Very well, thank you. What a fantastic bit of advice to maintain your suntan, go and live in Guernsey.
Well, mine is, you want some sea salt from your supermarket.
We're back to bathing in salt water, are we?
And you want some baby oil.
Aha, this is looking up.
And you put a handful of sea salt in your hand, and then you pour on the baby oil, and you rub the both into your skin.
You're not related to Captain Blythe, are you?
No, this doesn't hurt, honestly.
Oh, no.
It's just a slight coarse sensation, nothing worse than shaving. And it takes all your dry, flaky skin off.
Good,
then you have a bath.
Yeah.
And you moisturise your skin with your ordinary suntan oil. And keep your skin moisturised, and as it's beginning to fade, you want 2 or 3 courses on a suntan bed.
A sunbed?
Yeah.
Oh, that's quite a good idea.
Need about 45 minutes, 15 minutes each thing, so you need 3 treatments, and that should keep your tan up well until October.
You reckon? So let me get this right. I need baby oil.
Yeah. And some coarse sea salt.
Some perfectly ordinary coarse sea salt.
From your local supermarket.
Of course.
And you put a handful of salt on your hand and pour the oil onto it.
Oil onto there. Slap it all over.
And then rinse it off in your bath. Moisturise your skin all the time after you've had a bath, because the moisture will keep the tan in and stop it flaking.
Why does it flake? My leg, look at that.
It's dead skin on the top. What happens is it's dead skin on the top, isn't it? You have so many layers of skin, and the top layers you've burnt brown. So to keep it up, you want to keep it moisturised.
But why does it never peel when you're in the sun?
Because if you're by the sea, as Bill says, the salt air opens the pores up, and so you're sweating over the top of your skin.
I do not sweat, I perspire.
You perspire then, and it keeps your skin moist. That is the reason.
So if you're sweaty...
Yeah.
You don't peel.
If you're in salt air is the thing that will keep your pores open to keep you tan.
So if you see somebody with a perfectly enhanced suntan walking down the road, you're perfectly at liberty to yell out, "Oi, sweaty."
That's right.
Oh, yeah. I remember that.
Well, if you look at somebody who's got a deep tan, you'll see their skin is more shinier than anyone else's. It's because of the moisture on the surface that keeps the skin moist, which retains your tan. If you see somebody fading, that you'll see them dry and flaky. That's because they haven't moisturised the skin. You've got to keep your skin moisturised to keep your tan in. But if you start going a yellowy colour, you need to...
You've got jaundice.
Either you've had kidney failure, liver trouble.
Great. I'll make a note of that.
No, that's true. That's what, when I was a Revlon beauty consultant, that's what we used to do at the chemist, you see.
Did you... You were one of those women who worked behind the counter?
Yeah.
Like, and they're all made up to the nines?
Yes.
Did you get told to wear that much makeup?
When I was a Revlon consultant, yeah. You had to wear so many eye colours, three or four eye colours, different toned in, yeah. Your hair had to be immaculate and your nails as well, yeah.
You couldn't do that now, though, could you?
No, 20 years on, I'm overweight and my
I didn't mean that. I mean, what I meant was...
I'm not glamorous now, Ian, no. I've gone to the dogs.
No, what I meant was that because of sex discrimination...
Yes, you couldn't sell your product without looking as if you were using the stuff, no.
Yeah, but then how could a bloke get that job?
Yeah, well, it'd be a bit difficult, wouldn't it?
Well, I suppose there's one or two.
Yeah, I suppose if they...
I
suppose this day and age, if you look well kept in your job, yeah, you're okay.
No, I thought Julie...
It's no good going to somebody with rotten teeth, greasy hair and that, and load of pimples and
then
asking for something to treat spots and that, is it?
Not really, no.
No.
No, I accept that. Maybe Julie and Clary could do the job.
The thing I was ringing about, actually, was what do you think of this hospital scan thing used for sheep? I think that's...
Is this in Wales?
No. Well, in Worcester. It was the Artlands Hospital in Birmingham. I had out their CT scanner to be used on testing sheep. And yet the Princess Royal Hospital in Telford has been raising £180,000 and needs another £420,000 to get their own scanner. I think it's a bit disgusting that they can't be loaned out all over the place.
I know this is probably going to come as a completely stupid question.
Yeah.
Why were they scanning sheep? What was wrong with the sheep? Had the sheep been to the doctors? I'm not feeling well, doctor. It's okay, sheep will send you for a scan.
Oh, it's some sort of their breed test on breeding potential, I think, in rams.
So,
sounds a bit ridiculous when I'm reading it in the paper, considering we've got a waiting list in Telford and Shrewsbury.
What, to find out how randy you are?
No, to use a scanner.
Well, I don't understand how they could put a ram in a scanner and find out how horny it felt.
I don't know, I can't, well, what do they quite do? Understand that.
What do they do if it isn't feeling randy? Do they get a sheet with a suspender belt on and walk it up and down in front of it?
I've no idea.
Show it pictures, centre page from Sheep Breeders Weekly. There you go, hey, look at that, it's working, look at the scanner, hey.
I don't know, I haven't got quite the gist of that, why they were doing it. Anyway, that's what they put in the paper. It's to test the breeding potential of these rams in these sheep.
sounds very, very strange.
Oh, dear.
No, sorry we can't do your hip replacement operation, but we've got a load of unhorny rams down there.
But it seems a bit unfair, doesn't it, when it's public donations, as they're buying these CT scanners anyway, and then they're hiring them out for whatever.
For a sex clinic for sheep.
Yeah.
Dear me.
Okay.
What if they get a gay sheep?
Oh, God, don't say that. We'll have Ken on next.
Yes, I suppose so. Well, Katrina, thank you very much for what's going to be one of the most bizarre calls we've ever taken, all about a sex clinic for randy sheep.
I'm reading what it says in the paper.
I believe it. Must be true. If it's in the paper, it must be true. That's what my old granny used to say to me. All right, Petrina, thanks for that.
Bye.
Sarah. There you go. It gets weirder and weirder, this country. 754-123 in Wolverhampton. 236-235 in Shrewsbury. And we'll be back after this award-winning commercial break.
On summer mornings, the hush is near perfect. You might just catch the murmur of the riverbed, or perhaps a snatch of birdsong. But nothing else can disturb the stillness, except for...
Except for all those people rushing to pick up a new Renault before prices go up on September 15th. Deals at these outstanding summer prices include 0% finance on petrol Renault 19s and Clios, and there's a £460 cash back on all Renault diesel cars. So hurry down now before they...
all go.
Finance subject to status and cashback offers end October 29th. For written details, call Renault UK on 0800 52 51 50.
Set sail with Beacon Radio this November for our fantastic listeners' cruise to Sweden. We depart on Friday the 26th of November aboard the Princess of Scandinavia, a superb floating hotel where you can enjoy restaurants, bars, cinema and even a sauna. We travel overnight to Gothenburg, one of Sweden's most beautiful cities, where we'll take a guided tour of all the sights, returning Sunday night with souvenirs and a memory of a great trip. It's a smorgasbord of fun for just £74 per person. You can find out more by calling 0255 241 234 and ask for extension 663. That's 0255 241 234.
It's a rich man's world.
We asked Gary Humphreys what Walton's meant to him.
I went to a lot of dealerships dealing with all the different cars, because you can have any make or model of car on the marketability. But when I came to Walton's, I had the quality service. Then they didn't just give me a loud leaflet and says, come back when you're ready. It was really a good personal service. When I came, they gave me a drive to see if I could fit in. They adapted the car for me at the garage. And when it was delivered, it was all there and ready to drive. It was a very big help for me to get my independence back. And I'm very much grateful to Walton's of Stafford for giving me that.
Try the Waltons of Stafford experience. The fresh approach to Vauxhall.
Line on Beacon and WABC. It's a free-for-all, so you can talk about anything you want to talk about. Sex clinics for sheep, whatever. 754-123 in Wolverhampton, 236-235 in Shrewsbury. Next, on the lines with the most famous catchphrase the world has ever known, it's Eric! Good morning, Eric! Who's listening to his wireless? Kel Surprise, the mind. We're given the regulation 6 seconds before he hits you with his catchphrase. Which is... Eric calls. Hello, full extended 18-inch mix this morning. The Hang On Ian catchphrase in full cry from Eric. Good morning, Eric. Hello. Is that you? Is that you, Eric?
What?
What? Hello, Eric.
Good morning, Ian.
Good morning, Eric. What a fine catchphrase that is.
Christine and I bet them sheep and...
Petrina. Yes. Sex clinic for sheep, Eric.
Yeah, it's coming how far the ram can go, because it's choking a good many sheep.
Is that right, is it? Thank you. The show plumbs new depths, courtesy of Eric.
Ian, I was listening to a programme on television tonight. I wonder... ...to women at work...
Well, I saw an article in the newspaper today in the Daily Fascist that said that, I think it was Thames, or some council down south, were basically publicising, they'd taken a leaflet campaign out to encourage men to report sexual harassment at work if they were being sexually harassed by women. Never happened to me.
Never happened to me. But I was listening to a programme tonight and he said, and one bloke said to a woman, how would you like me to put my pee between your teeth?
Eh?
You know.
Oh, did he?
Huh?
Did he now?
Yeah.
Was this a documentary, Eric?
Yeah. It's a documentary on...
sexual discrimination?
Yeah. And another said, I'd like to put my pee up your A. you know.
So they all talk in code, do they, in these?
But they wasn't just pronouncing it like that.
They were saying it.
They more.
What happened to the people then?
Well, there's one woman. There was one woman that had £2,000 compensation, and there was another woman only had £30.
Well, what happened to the blokes who did this?
Well, the one bloke was, as did it, he was transferred to another firm, to another company, another plant or something. And there was another bloke who was dismissed because he was in the front of the tribunal, and this one bloke said to him, he said, "Why did you pull your zip down in the front of my client?" He said, "I didn't. I came out accidentally out of the toilet and forgot to pull my zip up."
Is this widespread, you believe, Eric?
Oh, it definitely is, Ian. Women, I mean, a woman can't go to work unless she dresses up. I might as well go to work in bloody harmony as where there's men like that, you know.
Don't women use it, though, to an extent?
Huh?
Don't women use it to an extent?
No. I mean, they might as well go to work with tin suits on. Because where there's men like that, I mean, they want castrating, they want burning.
You're in Captain Napalm mode, you are, aren't you?
I don't like to see to think that a woman can't do her job through having her bottom pinched or...
Oh, come on, that's only got to be a minority of cases, isn't it?
I don't know, but it's going on, it's on the television every Monday night.
Is it? And tune in next week.
Don't a lot of
women send out the wrong signals, though?
I don't think, no, not according to the way they was talking in this tribunal, on this tribunal.
So
one bloke turned around, denies everything, and when the wench went to the tribunal, he called her, made her a liar and everything that, or played the tape. Left a tape on in the office.
Was it a hidden camera or a hidden microphone?
No, it was just a tape. And they left it on in the office and him talking.
So he was banged to rights, was he?
In other words, it was him that was telling the lies. But it comes to something, doesn't it, Ian? If a woman can't go and do her job without being harassed by men...
And you reckon this is fairly widespread?
I think it is, according to television. It's got to be, according to the way they're talking on television.
Well, if it's on the telly, it must be true.
Yeah, that's correct.
Because they wouldn't broadcast lies, would they?
No, I don't know. You see, it shows you them, the people, there's the commentator, and then there's the people being interviewed. And then at the back of them is a tribunal.
But then if they were trying to make a television programme from it, isn't there an argument that says that what they could have done is blown up the incidences out of all proportion just to make good telly?
Well, I wouldn't think they'd put a...
I would.
I wouldn't think they'd make a programme about a firm. What do they call it? I can't remember the initials. The CMA or somewhat, or the EMA or CAI or somewhat like that.
So you reckon that in England, 1993, this is still widespread?
Oh, definitely, Ian. I mean, it isn't safe for a woman to walk the streets. It's not safe for a woman to be left alone on her own, a young woman or anything of that. I mean, when you look at it, the rotters that's going about as regards men, it's no good to saying men are Christians. They're not Christians. It's like it said in the Bible that when God put man on earth, he put the wickedest beast he could think of.
I'd agree with you there.
And he did, and all.
Eric, we've got to move on, but we'll throw the lines open so that if anybody believes that they've been sexually harassed...
You've got my sweetheart back, haven't you?
Oh, I have.
Mavis?
Yes, your sweetheart, Mavis.
Oh, she's returned. Hey, Ian, what I wanted to ask you this.
Yes?
You know, the Edinburgh tattoo from Scotland comes on...
Yeah.
They have the changing of the guards in England.
Yeah.
What do they show thee in Welsh?
The reupholstering of the spinning wheel.
They're probably upholstering the pillars or something.
Yeah, it's definitely the reupholstering of the spinning wheel takes place in after the Ice Deadford.
Yeah, but it's never televised, is it?
Oh, no, it's too exciting. That's why.
That's the only place that doesn't show nothing.
What, Wales?
Yeah.
They have the skinning of the tourist. That's a daily event during the summer.
I think they're in Tories, all Tories down there, that's why.
All right then, Eric.
Okay, yeah.
Ta-ra.
God bless.
There we go, Eric, fair point that. If they have the changing of the guard in England and they have the tattoo, the ceremony of the MAM tattoo, which is televised as somebody, a Scotsman every year, has MAM tattooed on his arm at Edinburgh Castle, and that's televised to the world, that is. Well, what do you have in Wales? Because I'm sure it isn't really the reupholstering of the spinning wheel. I'm sure they've probably got something else. Right, sexual harassment. If you've been sexually harassed at work, tell us about it. 754123 in Wolverhampton, 236 235 in Shrewsbury. Next on this line here, we have Chip Shop Dave. Good morning.
Good morning. How are you?
Frying tonight.
This is it. I was.
Yeah, I was till the Villa result came in. Because I was saying to my mate at the weekend, I was saying that, you know, some people have got short memories, haven't they?
This is it.
Because, like, everybody seems to have forgotten that they were calling for Graham Souness's his resignation.
Yeah.
Not 2 months ago. Whereas I remember saying at the time, the man's a visionary. almost a saint. And how dare we mere mortals...
Have you got that thunder tape?
How dare we even try to guess at the grand plan? I remember distinctly saying that.
Yeah.
And if somebody was on a wireless saying sack him because he's a talentless git, it certainly wasn't me.
I'm stuck. No, I'm not stuck for words. But you haven't got that thunder tape with you, have you?
Not to
have,
no.
The lightning strikes.
Yeah, some people might have been calling for his resignation, but not me, Graham. No. I was always on your side, mate, in everything.
Your mate, Graham, now.
My big mate, Graham Souness, yeah. Top of the league, well, they were top of the league for first time in 29 months.
Yeah, not bad, eh?
Yeah, well, it didn't last very long. Still, after we've shown Tottenham Hotspur how to play football on Wednesday, I've no doubt they'll be back again.
This is it, Wednesday night, is it?
Yes, little Oswaldo Ardiles is going to get a walloping for leaving West Brom, so we're delivering this one on behalf of the Baggies.
Uh-huh.
This is for you, West Bromwich.
You had your mate playing for Swindon on there.
Mutch.
On Saturday, didn't you?
Andy Mutch.
Yeah.
Yes.
Did you see the game, or did you...
I listened to it.
You listened to it, yeah?
Because I'd actually predicted 6-0.
Yeah.
But it was... it would have been 6 if the referee hadn't pulled play back for a foul on Mulby.
Uh-huh.
Mutchy was playing. He's recently left Wolverhampton Wanderers. From the same road I am.
Yeah,
I'm... Another claim to fame.
This is it.
Go back a long way.
Yeah.
We wouldn't let him play with us.
You never do cheeky kids, do you?
No, well,
cheeky good kids.
I used to knock around with his brother, Peter.
Yeah. Did he play for anybody?
No. He was about as hopeless at football as I was, which is saying something. Enthusiastic, I think, is the way to describe my...
Did you used to go and watch England train? Because they always used to train in Southport, didn't they?
Did they?
Yeah.
No.
They have one of the best football pitches in the country at Southport.
What, Hague Avenue?
I can't remember the name of the pitch, but I know England used to train there.
Well, my school was just behind there, and we certainly didn't see any passing England players.
Because they've gone up to the GM conference now, haven't they?
Yes, they have. They, did they win? Was it 3-2 or did they get beat? Oh, they drew 3-3, I'm being told.
Yeah. Against, was it Dagenham and Redbridge?
Aye. Yes, I put me back in the Football League to be greeted by an absolute massive burst of apathy from the people of Southport.
Mm. It's a shame, really.
Oh, it's shocking business. The problem is, you've got Rovers, you've got Liverpool, and you've got Everton all within 20 minutes.
Yeah, what about this? Because there was a piece in one of the football magazines that said they're going to change Tranmere Rovers' name to Wirral Athletic.
Why?
because the local council wanted to sponsor them. They wanted them to change the name to Wirral Athletic.
No chance.
And I thought that was definitely a non-football sort of
Wirral Athletic?
Wirral Athletic, yeah.
What a stupid name for a football club. We're all athletics. It doesn't rhyme, does it?
Can't believe that.
Can't do it.
It's definitely so that somebody doesn't understand football at all.
Did you watch the derby on Sunday?
Yeah, that's what I was going to ring you about.
Quite exciting, that, I thought.
Did you?
I like that pistachio bloke.
Pesca Salido?
Yeah, well, it's just easy for you to say.
Well, I've seen him before. He's a good player.
Pistachio. Yeah, he's live, wasn't he, right? Yeah, little live was, wire.
He's only been in football in this country for less than a year, I think. And he showed good form last year down at the Wolves. Because I'm a Wolves fan, so not too happy.
I think I've seen him before.
Yeah?
Wasn't he a munchkin in The Wizard of Oz?
He's got the haircut, hasn't he?
He certainly has. Definitely seen him somewhere, I'm sure it was that.
Yeah. It's a good idea for somebody who wants to make a fortune.
Oh, great, yeah, fine. I'd like to make a fortune.
Yeah, it's for curing...
Does this involve armed robbery?
No, it's for curing insomniacs.
Fine.
Going to sneak into the Wolves' dressing room and tape Graham Turner's half-time football lecture.
Right, lads, go out there and lose 2 goals pretty damn quick.
Well, they did it this Saturday as well. Previous Saturday, they were one up, and because every time they come out, fast asleep. And it'd be a great... You know, you could really make some money if you could... tape it, one of his half-time lectures.
Listen, lads, we're winning and this'll never do.
Yeah, this is it. I just can't believe it. I want to give him a triple F formula.
What's
the famous football formula?
What's that? Well, I'll tell you what, we'll find out what that is, because we're going to go to the news, but we'll find out just after the news what the... Was it triple F?
The triple F, yeah.
I know. I think I'm going to clear this before we broadcast it. Anyway, we'll be back to find out what the triple F formula is. Hope you do watch the game on Sunday, because it's a jolly good game, very exciting if you were neutral like what I am. 754-123 in Wolverhampton, 236-235 in Shrewsbury. It's the Midnight Line on Beacon and WABC. It's a free-for-all, so you can talk about anything you want to talk about, and we'll be back after this. Beacon
Radio News. The 1 o'clock news, this is Peter Russell. The UN is waiting anxiously to see whether Bosnian Croats will keep their promise to allow an aid convoy into Mostar, where more than 50,000 people are starving. At first, the Croats refused to let food and medical supplies through to the besieged town, but have since agreed to its passage after hours of negotiations. Lindal Sachs of the UNHCR says they want to evacuate the sick and injured.
My colleague really was very shocked by what he saw, the very severity of the injuries that a large number of children had sustained. Until we can actually get in and assess the situation, it's almost impossible for us to even consider some sort of operation similar to Operation Irma.
Another senior US government official has resigned in protest at America's policy towards Bosnia. Stephen Walker, a State Department expert on Croatia, is the third to quit this month. He says American policy is encouraging genocide, and he's urging Washington to arm Bosnia's Muslims. Two of Saddam Hussein's senior diplomats have fled to Britain, reportedly to join the Iraqi opposition in exile. One is believed to be a former ambassador to Britain. The Foreign Office has confirmed two leading Iraqi officials have been granted leave to remain in the UK, but says it doesn't amount to full-scale political asylum. Miners will decide today whether to take the government to court over planned changes to the running of Britain's collieries. Delegates from the Pit Deputies Union, NACODS, are expected to challenge moves to take away their responsibility for safety on the grounds it was approved without parliamentary debate. Labour's employment spokesman, Frank Dobson, says the change would increase the risk of another Bilsthorpe disaster.
At present, Britain's mines are the safest in the world because the deputy is the person responsible for safety and because there are detailed regulations. Under the new arrangements, there would be vague guidance instead, and the duty of the deputy would be split between the deputy and the mine management. Some of those mine managers would be more interested in productivity than safety.
Independent Radio News.
The latest satellite picture is produced by John Warner from orbital station Meteosat 4, the most accurate forecast.
Yes, lovingly constructed by John Warner, and once again carelessly lost by Ian Perry. Oh, here it is. Here we go. Oh, you don't want to know. Anyway, ground frost in places overnight. The low 3 Celsius, 37 degrees Fahrenheit. Sunshine and scattered showers with a cool northerly wind today. Maximum temperature 16 Celsius, 61 degrees Fahrenheit. Wednesday, scattered showers and dry with sunny spells on Friday. Temperature now 4 Celsius. That's 39 degrees Fahrenheit. Beacon Radio. Okie dokie, me old culture lovers, let's find out what the triple F formula is. I've actually been thinking, which is a rather dangerous state of affairs, and I wouldn't actually recommend anybody to do it unaided, but, it used to be the four Fs, didn't it? This is broadcastable, is it?
I didn't hear you click into me.
Yeah, I clicked into you.
Oh.
You've been clicked into.
You didn't hear me coughing, did you?
No. God bless you.
It was triple X, the other one.
Triple X.
No, 4X, wasn't it? 4X. Yeah. This is repeatable.
This is
serious. You know, all famous football managers, from the first one, which was the bloke that was in charge of Preston North End in 1886, he had this formula.
Who was that, then?
His name's just slipped me, but...
He's that famous?
Yeah, he was that famous.
1886,
Can you remember? Well, Preston North End won the cup 6 times.
Did
it all between 1886 and 1895.
I was going to say they haven't won anything since, have they?
That's because the manager lost this formula.
Oh, dear. he should have committed it to memory. It's his own fault.
Well, this is why Kenny Dalglish left Liverpool, because he lost the formula, you see.
And off he went.
And off he went, yeah.
So now you can exclusively reveal on the Midnight Line at Beacon and WABC what that formula is.
It's R plus F equals C.
Oh, well, great, that's cleared up a few little queries I might have had. There we go, if you want to win the league and you want to win the cup, R plus F equals C. Also, don't forget that E equals MC squared.
That's it. That's according to Einstein, isn't it?
It's one of Albert's, this, is it? R plus F equals C.
Well, this is it, you see.
God, is that it?
It's as simple as that.
R plus F equals C.
Yep, and every Wolves fan will know this, you see.
So, for example, C equals 5, then R could equal 2 and F could equal 3, couldn't it?
Yeah.
But thanks for that.
It doesn't actually go up that high, you know, because R is result.
Result. Now we're getting to the bones of it, right. Yeah. Result.
Yeah, and F is form.
Plus form.
And C is changes.
Right.
So, what you do is if they win, R equals naught.
Right. So, let's do Liverpool at the moment, right, okay. Result. The result equals naught, right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Plus F, which is the form, which is either good or bad.
Good.
Yeah. But good is naught.
Yeah.
And poor is one.
Right.
Yeah. So, and it equals changes, the number of players you drop.
None.
That's it.
That's pretty good, isn't it?
Well, that's it.
What if they're injured?
Well, then you make excuses. Now, that's what a manager's really there for.
Yes, okay, fair enough. A bit like a politician.
Yeah. You get lies, damn lies, and politicians, don't you?
So, you could actually amend that formula, because, I mean, 1886 is about time it was updated a bit. You could have R plus F equals C.
Yeah. Well, you see, if
plus
you
lose, I.
Yeah, if you lose, R is 2. And if you draw, R is 1.
And that's the... So, at any time, you would only, you'd only drop 3 players.
Yeah. Yeah, because you've got to keep it... So, you've got to just change slowly.
Continuity, young man.
Just got to let them know, lad.
Continuity, young man.
Yeah, you've got to let them know, though, lad. But, see, every Wolves fan understands this, but not the manager, you see. Because every time the Wolves play badly, he just says, that was just a one-off, we'll give them another chance. And then they lose again, you see.
Right, so... Why don't you post him the formula?
Pardon?
Why don't you post him the formula?
Because he might get lost in the post, you see, and a sort of a Birmingham City fan might get hold of it, something like that, you know.
That's okay, they wouldn't understand it.
A West Baggies Albion fan.
We're going to do...
An Ollie Bean.
Okay, so R plus F equals C. Follow these simple rules.
This is it.
And you'll have a successful footy team.
This is it.
All right then, Dave.
Okay.
Thanks for that.
Yeah. Oh, and about sexual harassment.
Yes.
It happens to me every night, and then I wake up.
Yeah, me too. All right then. Ta-ra, Dave.
All right.
There we go, Chip Shop Dave with the formula R plus F equals C, and that's guaranteed to bring you footballing success. Who have we got next? We have got John. John's a first-time caller, and he's on this line. Good morning.
Good morning, Ian.
Good morning, John.
Yeah, well, you know the person who was on about the prisons earlier, about half an hour ago?
Yes.
Yeah, well, I'd just like to make a point about that. He's partly right in the fact that when someone goes to jail, the law doesn't actually make it, you know, actually doesn't make them serve their punishment properly, as in, working their fingers to the bone, yeah?
Yeah.
If you get me, yeah. And, And I think he's wrong, though, in the fact that, you know, the people, the company in prison that they have, you know, the other people, the other accused people, that they...
The other inmates.
Yeah, the inmates, okay. I think that he's wrong in the fact, because the inmates, some of them, they're drug pushers, wouldn't you say, and they just give them a really hard time and bully them and beat them up, wouldn't you say?
I think, I don't know, I got invited to go and address a group of lifers at Featherstone, which I'll write to them this week.
Mm-hmm.
And I wouldn't mind a quick look round the priz.
Yeah, it forces them to go onto the roof as well, yeah. Because they're going to the roof.
Well, the problem, you see, as far as I can see it, if you say, right, what we're going to do with our prisons is we're going to make them work hard,
mm-hmm.
then they're going to produce something, aren't they?
Yeah.
Right? And they're not going to get paid. They're not going to get paid market rates for it. So what you've effectively done mm-hmm. is established an order of slave labour.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
And I rather thought Wilberforce sort of death that one out.
Right.
I mean, is it right to make a slave labour force?
Well, no, it's not, but that's not really my point. I'm just saying that if the prisons, if the people want to do that, then that's fine with them, but I think they've already got enough, a hard enough time with the inmates.
Sorry, who have? The authorities?
Well, the people who've just come in to prison, they'll already have a hard enough time in prison.
Adapting?
I reckon they will, because remember that drama that was on? You've heard of the Birmingham Six affair, and, you know, Michael Hickey is innocent and everything. Yeah, you probably heard of that.
Yes, I have.
Yeah, did you see it on TV when it was on?
Now you come to mention it. Probably. I can't remember, to be
quite
honest.
Yeah, it was just a dramatised event of what happened and how he was convicted. You see, the time they gave him on TV, I mean, you said to Captain Napalm earlier that you believe everything that's on TV, didn't you?
Yeah. I do.
Yeah, so, yeah, well, I do as well. So, it showed what they did to him in prison. And they just stuck fountain pens in his hands and just basically bullied him and smashed him in because they thought he killed an 8-year-old, how old was he? 11-year-old boy, Carl Bridgewater, when he didn't.
But then the problem that you have in those environments is it tends to be the first timers, I suppose, who have the problem mm-hmm. adapting to the system. And if you're a regular old lag, it's just like going home, isn't it?
And it's a British justice as well, because nowadays convicting the wrong people has become much more common. With organised crime and that, so that's the bad thing about the system as well.
Well, they reckon there are. I've actually never got a letter off a prisoner who's. They're all innocent. And there's more innocent people in jails than there are on the outside.
Yeah, I get you. Yeah, well, that was really my point. And about football as well. You think Liverpool will win the title?
I know they're going to win the title.
Yeah, I think I'm Liverpool supporter as well. I'm not too sure. I reckon you're right about us giving Tottenham a walloping on Wednesday, but I don't think we can produce this form that we've produced at the beginning in the long term.
Of course you can, Malcolm. Of course you can. I think that it's the same with any league. Is that you shouldn't really pay that much attention to the opening results. The real campaign is over the winter.
Yeah, that's true.
Because that's what tests your depth of squad.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the one that separates the men from the boys.
That's very true, yeah, I agree. That's basically...
But I reckon Swindletown got what they deserved, and Tottenham are going to be getting it on behalf of West Bromwich Albion on Wednesday night.
I honestly hope Tottenham will get it, because they've just done all their bad deals. They take virtually every transfer to the tribunal, don't they?
Sorry, who do?
Tottenham, they take virtually every transfer to the tribunal, don't they? Jason Dizell, Colin Calderwood, and Ruddock as well.
They did take Ruddock.
Yeah, they took him to the tribunal. Southampton wanted $1.5 million. And Tottenham got him for just under $500,000.
Well, I hope, as I say, on behalf of West Bromwich Albion, that Ozzy Idealis goes out of Anfield with a red face.
Yeah.
I've got to move on, mate. Okay, but again, didn't hurt a bit, did it?
Yeah.
All right, speak to you again. 754-123 in Wolverhampton, 236, 235 in Shrewsbury. I'll give me gob a rest. We'll take a track from our featured CD album, which this morning is the best of Rufty Tufty, Rod Stewart. And here he is, the lad himself. With a cover of the Sam Cooke classic, Twisting the Night Away.
Who are the trouble on the road?
Tufty Rod Stewart from the best of Rod Stewart. That's Twisting the Night Away on Beacon and WABC's Midnight Line. It's the phone-in show that your radio was invented for. The one that Marconi had in mind. Okay, who've we got next? Oh, lucky old us, because on this line here, he's camper than a row of tents. He's Scott. Good morning.
Hello, Ian.
Hello, Scott.
How are you?
All right, still camping out, are you?
Right, there are a couple of things. You didn't have any close encounters when you were an allergy, did you, with a wasp?
I did actually, yeah. the final score, if anybody missed it last week, was Corfu Wasps 0, Ian 2. And one of which was X'd off this planet and for coming too close to me while I was eating. And what I did was I found an ant.
An ant.
An ant. Not as in my mother's sister or anything like that, but I found an ant, so I put the wasp down by the ant, and the ant went and told all his little anti mates where the wasp was, and they all came mob-handed and carried it back to the nest.
Mind you, you're still as mad as ever, right? The other thing is, I'd like to congratulate the athletics. I don't think England done too bad at all.
Well, they say there's some faith healer in London walking around at the moment doing shows, and his logo is Miracles Do Happen. I reckon our athletics team and the English cricket team must have been to see him.
Oh, I don't like cricket. I like the athletics.
Don't like cricket.
Every
red-blooded Englishman will have been waving a flag and shouting hurrah today.
It's boring, just batting a ball.
Boring? How can cricket... Right, so cricket's boring, right?
Yeah.
Okay, is Rod Stewart boring?
Well, yeah, actually, I didn't like that song that you just played.
Well, it likes you.
Well, the other thing is, Whitney Houston's coming to Birmingham.
Oh, hang out the flags.
She's well known.
Dabs in the streets.
Don't you like her?
Oh, yeah.
She's excellent. You don't
boring.
Know good music.
Boring.
Right. Now, if anybody's got any tickets that they want to sell, could they get in touch with you? And if they get in touch with me, because I've tried to get some tickets, but they've sold out or something, or I can get rubbish seats. I'd like a couple of good seats.
Well, on the stage or something.
Oh, yeah. In the dressing room.
Yeah, okay. I can see the logic in that.
Knows. I think she's really nice, right? Now, remember...
How did Whitney... Where was she playing, then? Phone box.
Pardon?
She playing a phone box.
She's at the NEC.
And she's sold out?
Yeah. She's on Monty Shine on for a couple of nights.
Well, so you want some Whitney Houston tickets?
Yes, please.
But only good ones?
Yeah, and they'd be even better if somebody wanted to donate a couple.
Well, it's right. All that romantic slush, isn't
it? Oh, it's wicked. It's really good. Right, now, remember my chicken? Remember that thing about my chicken?
Your chicken?
Yeah, remember.
You have a chicken?
Remember that rotten one?
Ah, wait a minute. Yes, you bought a rotten chicken.
That's right. And I phoned the manager up of a big store, and I said, well, we'll refund your chicken, but we can't refund the food that you lost.
What, like the potatoes and things?
And beef. Anyway...
Why did you lose food? Was it a mutant chicken from hell that attacked the rest of your fridge or something?
He ate all my food. It was still alive, getting around in my fridge. No, what happened was it was in my fridge and, like, it was really potent and it lacquered all my food and, like, you know, it stunk all my food. Anyway, then the manager said, well, like, we can replace chicken.
I found a worm in a can of tomatoes at the weekend. That's what I thought,
Mind you, it's better than finding half a maggot in half an apple.
Yes, that's true.
Anyway, I got in touch with the Environmental Health and they come and pick my chicken up and nothing was progressing. They said, you know, they'd got in touch and one thing or another. They said they had no other complaints, so there's not much that I can do.
I'm pleased you're telling us this because I've had a few letters about people who said they've not been able to sleep at nights because they never reached the conclusion of what happened to your potent chicken.
Anyway, I had the environmental health up again, after what had been happening, and they said, well, nothing, but they will refund you the money for your chicken, which was £1.80 odd, and I thought, oh, bloody hell, like. Anyway, a few days later, I had a letter come, an apology letter, from the store, but I've been told I can't name the store.
Who by?
The person who answers the phone.
Oh, all right, fair enough. He knows more about legal stuff than I do. So the store sent you a letter saying, we're terribly sorry we sold you a Duff chicken, here's £1.80.
No, they sent me £25. They sent me £25 in gift vouchers.
That's £23, 20 profit, that's.
So,
that's not bad, is it?
Profit. Oh, yeah, no, sorry, 20, yeah. So I was quite happy with getting my chicken back. Well, it wasn't so much as the 25 quid as...
I wonder what you get for a worm in a can of tomatoes.
I don't know.
Evil little thing, you'd see its
probably
eyes.
Send you a sack of soil or something, lovely.
Oh, I'll grow my own tomatoes.
Your own maggots, worms.
Yeah, it's only a little worm. I mean, probably if it was Mexico, it's the sort of worm you stick in beer when you drink, you know?
How much did you have to drink whilst you was away?
I didn't touch anything.
Get away with
you. I didn't touch anything. I didn't have a drink while I was away.
You made up for it when you come back?
No, I've gone totally teetotal. I've seen the light and now believe that Thora Heard is the son of God.
Did you bring me anything back?
Well, I don't know. I'll let you know when we get the results from the test.
You never brought me nothing back, did you? And I asked you to.
Yeah, I did bring you nothing.
Yeah, that's the only
absolutely
thing
big zippo.
Thank you.
And in fact, I've got to tell you, Scott, that in all the time I was away, you didn't cross my mind once.
That is nasty. I haven't spoke to you.
I'm only being honest.
I haven't spoke to you for ages and you're picking on me.
I'm not picking on you, Scott. But anyway, we're glad that you made £23.20. Who's next? Who have we got here? We've got Boris. Good morning, Boris.
Hello.
Hello, Boris. Didn't bring you anything back either.
Ah, no.
I know. Tragic, isn't it?
Yeah, okay.
I could have bought you one of those rather nice little Greek dolls in national costume. They're very nice, aren't they?
Oh, definitely.
They would adorn anybody's living room. The height of sartorial elegance.
Well, that's it. That's it.
What can we do for you, Boris?
Have you read The Sun? Well, it's yesterday now. Yesterday's Sun.
I did, unfortunately.
Yeah, did you see the front page?
This is 20p until next year.
No, the bit next to it.
Oh, score 3 times from 12 yards and win £1 million.
Yes, that's it. Do you think any of our Midland footballers can do that?
I was trying to think of the way...
Retire.
For anybody who hasn't seen, what you've got to do is you've got like a goal drawn out, yeah?
Mm.
And then there's 3 holes drilled in the goal. One at the bottom left, one in the centre, and one in the top. Now, the top one is just, I think, half an inch bigger than the actual ball you're kicking.
Yes,
And if you can kick the balls... Sounds a bit rude, all this, doesn't it? if you can kick the balls through the holes with 3 shots, then you win £1 million.
That's it. And
I hope John Barnes doesn't enter because he'll injure himself.
Well, do you want to hear the advice from Teddy Sheringham? That's a...
Not really.
Well...
But go on.
The England striker Teddy Sheringham has also had a fun shot at our challenge and was just wide of the mark.
So he missed.
Yeah.
That's what they're saying, isn't it?
Yeah.
But only in nicer terms.
So
he missed.
What chance have we got?
Well, I was trying to decide how best to enter it, and I decided the best thing to do would be to blindfold yourself. Because there's no point aiming at it. Are you going to have a go at this?
Well, it's coming to Birmingham, so I might pop down there, yeah, and have a go. You never know. Because, I mean, it says here as well, if more than one person does it, they share the prize.
Can you honestly see one person doing this?
No, not at all. Not at all. I can't even see any professional doing it.
Although professionals are banned.
Yeah, I know, and semi-professional.
And given that your average Sun reader has a hit replacement and a blue rinse, I can't really see Granny Miggins from round the corner netting the 3. And if they do, I suggest some large football team sign her.
Well, I can see a lot of professionals going down there.
What, with moustaches on and false glasses? You look a bit like John Bond.
No, never heard of him, mate. Never heard of John who? No, never.
Never.
I mean, hey, did they check you out?
Well, I don't suppose they do they? I suppose that once you start putting your hand out for the £1 million, they might start asking a few questions.
So you'll see John Barnes in, like, he has a hairstyle or something.
I reckon you could be right.
Page.
But I mean, as I say, John Barnes, I hope he doesn't do it, because he'll just injure himself.
Any of the Midlands.
As somebody who couldn't hit a barn door from 12 yards, I don't think I've got any chance.
They're lucky to score, like, 5 penalties from 12 yards with the goalkeeper in there. I mean, okay, the goalie might save it once. But, I mean, you ask anybody to not have 5 penalties and to score all 5 of them, and then you've got to try and get a ball, half an inch?
Half an inch bigger than the circumference of the ball, yeah, so you've got to be dead accurate with it.
Well, it isn't dead accurate, I mean, it's impossible. You've got to get the first two, yes.
Yeah, but the first one's quite easy, isn't it? I mean, it looks like the size of a dog kennel. So just pretend that you were booting your ball at your dog or something like that, and that's number one done. Number two looks a little more difficult, and number three looks patently impossible.
I think they all look impossible.
But you're going to have a go.
Oh, yeah, I'll have a go.
I'll tell you what, when you have a go...
Yep.
When is it? It's in Birmingham.
28th of August.
Okay. So that's only a few days away, isn't it?
Yeah.
So
Saturday, yeah.
Saturday. So when we do the free-for-all this time next week...
Yeah.
What we want you to do...
Yeah.
...is to ring up...
Yeah.
...and tell us how you went on.
Yes, I will. Definitely.
Because I believe that in as well as winning the £1 million, you ought to be immediately selected to go and represent your country at international level.
Oh, definitely. Well, I reckon they should get the England team then. At least they can retire if they win it.
But it'd be embarrassing, wouldn't it, if you missed? I mean, well, who was it? Teddy Sheringham?
Yeah.
He missed.
Well, he plays for Spurs, so, I mean, you're going to whop him, ain't you?
So now he's known as the man who can't even win a sun competition. Yeah, I think if I was a professional footballer, I'd duck out of it. But wish you good luck with it.
Yeah.
And remember who your friends are, Boris.
I will.
All right, mate.
Okay, thank you.
See you soon.
Bye.
All right. There we go. Boris having a crack at winning £1 million in the sun. All you got to do is score 3 highly improbable shots against a goal painted on the side of a lorry. Intellectual stuff, the sun, eh? And look at this, see? Children dying in Bosnia. The world's going crazy, but the front page of the Sun, 20p until next year, like we're bothered about it. Oh, well, I thought this was terrible. Sit back and relax for months, knowing there won't be a price rise in your most important part of your life. Buying the Sun every day. If buying the Sun every day is the most important part of your life, I suggest that you get on the phone immediately to the Samaritans. What else does it say? Something really sick-making somewhere. Actually, the entire thing's sick-making. Oh, here it goes. More than 300,000 new buyers. Here we go. I hope you got your buckets ready. You got your buckets and some Kleenex, because you're going to need it. More than 300,000 new buyers have joined the happiest band in the land. You are a great family of Sun readers. Who's next? That was Boris. We've spoken to John. So next we've got on this line here, good morning, Martin.
Good morning, Ian.
Are you going to have a go at the Fantastic Sun competition?
I don't think so, but I'll tell you what, if he gives you a Bermuda phone number to phone in next time, he'll tell he's won.
You won it, yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Are you one of the happiest band in the land, the great family of Sun readers?
No, I'm one of the happiest band in the land, and never buys the Sun.
No, I don't see it because it's in here. What else has it got in it today, then? Oh, fantastic. The Sun's 20p. This is the front page. The Sun's 20p. You could win £1 million, and the most important story, which they found space for just to the right of the masthead, is that Buckingham Palace could be turned into an all-year-round tourist attraction with the royal family moving to Windsor Castle. Who cares? Not me, mate.
The corgis, probably.
Yeah, it was.
A long way to go for a walk.
It is, isn't it? Anyway, what can we do you for?
Oh, fair enough about this mobile scanner thing. Apparently it cost £500,000.
Oh, back to the Randy Sheep.
Back to the Randy Sheep. It's the only one of its kind in the country. It's designed to help test for people with, like, leukemia and cancer. And the bozos at the Heartlands Hospital in Birmingham have decided to hire it out to the National Sheep Centre in Malvern for £1.50 a day to test for, it says, the breeding potential of rams.
What were they actually testing for?
I don't know.
How do you... How do you use a scanner like that to find out how a ram is?
It's possible.
If you just put it in with some sheet, you'll find out how randy it is.
Maybe they want to find out how randy it was. Maybe they want to find out sort of how good it was. Well,
so to speak.
Not how good it was. Is it going to produce good little sheep? I mean, are they going to be full of meat? If not, sort of def that one out and we'll sort of
But don't you find that out by prodding it? I hate the fact that this show is sounding approximately like Radio 4's Farming World, but don't you just prod it, find out if there's any meat on it? Or why don't you get it to sire some, lambs, kill them and eat them, and if they taste nice, then get it to, do some more for you?
Yeah, but obviously that's not scientific enough, and what they're going to have to... Well, apparently it's caused a great upset. I mean, the front page of the Star tonight, the chairman of the Shropshire Health Authority, David Lloyd, has said he's really, sort of really angry about this. Because he said it's rather unfortunate terminology.